Hi, I'm Jane Buckner from the Benaroya Research Institute in Seattle, Washington. Today, I am discussing work from a group of investigators at the Benaroya Research Institute and the medical staff at Virginia Mason Medical Center. The COVID-19 pandemic has brought into focus the important role of the immune system in both protection from SARS-CoV-2 infection, but also its contribution to the morbidity and mortality that we see in some patients with COVID-19. The purpose of this study was to take a broad look at the immune landscape in the blood of patients with COVID-19 using mass cytometry. Our goal was to determine how the immune landscape reflected the clinical features of the disease over time, with the hope that this would help inform our understanding of who and why some patients develop severe disease and how best to intervene in these patients. This study was done in April and May of 2020, early in the pandemic, and in order to minimize any interference in patient care, we utilized recovered samples from the clinical laboratory at Virginia Mason. We were able to recruit 59 patients with COVID-19 for this study, 7 of whom had mild disease, were seen as outpatients, so we have a single sample from those individuals. 28 had moderate disease and were hospitalized but did not require treatment in the ICU, and 24 had severe disease requiring intensive care, and the majority of whom required mechanical ventilation. In addition to these 59 patients, we also collected samples from 17 patients hospitalized at the same time who were SARS-CoV-2 negative. These samples were collected from the clinical lab and CyTOF analysis was performed. The CyTOF panel we used was designed to assess the composition of the innate and lymphocyte compartments and determine the maturation lineage and activation status of these cell populations. This is a slide just to show you what our cohort looked like. For every day the individuals in the hospital, we have a circle or a triangle. They're colored based on their ordinal score of disease severity. And the circles represent the times at which we were able to obtain blood samples and perform CyTOF analysis. With this data, we were able to assess the correlations between different cell populations as well as clinical labs and clinical features. What I'm showing here is unsupervised hierarchical clustering of the CyTOF data for each of the subjects' initial samples. And in doing this, we identified 3 major clusters of patients. Clusters A and B, which were predominantly T cell monocyte and DC clusters, were seen in our patients with less severe disease, whereas cluster C, a neutrophil predominant cluster with a paucity of other cell types, was seen in more severe disease. Importantly, since we had longitudinal samples in this study, we wanted to look at the trajectory of the immune response in moderate and severe disease. So for this, we examined closely the individuals who were hospitalized and fell into these 2 groups. And we observed that patients with moderate disease showed a signature of a productive antiviral response that appeared to resolve. But the patients with more severe disease had a very different immune signature over time, suggestive of an aberrant response and persistent inflammation. We were further able to use this longitudinal data to ask whether features associated with disease severity changed in conjunction with changes in clinical score. So we selected individuals around a change in ordinal score where we had data before and after that change, and then looked at how those cell types altered. And we were able to demonstrate quite nicely that as severe disease resolved with clinical improvement, these same features resolved as well, demonstrating the correlation between clinical score and the immune landscapes that we identified through this study. Using these longitudinal samples, we were also able to examine the immune signatures in our patient cohort in conjunction with the therapies that they received. And since this was early in the pandemic, we had quite a few patients receiving a variety of interventions. We selected 7 individuals treated with tocilizumab, all of whom had severe disease, and 7 treated with convalescent plasma. We observed a clear acute signature of tocilizumab treatment that shares some of the features and immunologic changes seen with clinical improvement, whereas there's really no acute change in the immune landscape with convalescent plasma treatment in these patients. Both of these therapies have not shown clear efficacy in COVID-19, although recent trials suggest there may be some benefit in severely ill patients treated with tocilizumab. One unique aspect of our study was our ability to compare COVID-19 patients to a group of concurrently hospitalized patients negative for SARS-CoV-2. In doing this, we were able to show that some of the features that have been thought to be very characteristic of severe SARS-CoV-2 are shared with other ill patients. This included the increased neutrophils, decreased T cells, and PDCs, as well as others. But we also did see some distinct features found in the severe patients and not in the control cohort. And that include the increase in central memory, CD4 TFH, CD8 DR positive, and in plasmablasts. This is suggestive of a response to viral infection. So in summary, we were able to demonstrate that immune features at presentation reflect disease severity and are altered with changes in clinical status. Moderate and severe COVID-19 have different immune trajectories which reflect the clinical status and can be altered by therapeutic interventions. Severe COVID-19 shares some immunologic features with other hospitalized patients, while there are features that are unique to this cohort of individuals. And finally, I think it's important to say that by the use of recovered samples and a strong collaboration with our clinical colleague, we were able to minimally interrupt medical care, rapidly recruit a cohort of individuals, and perform a longitudinal assessment of immune parameters in human subjects. And hopefully this experience can not only inform our understanding of COVID-19, but also other diseases in our hospitalized patients in the future.